Welcome to the worship experience for the weekend of Sunday, March 21st, 2021. This worship experience video, this worship on demand, has a couple of great elements on it, on a teaching on what it means to be able to look at God, and God is our Lord, and the nature of God by the Bible Project, as well as a couple of videos focusing on what it means to meditate as Jesus followers on the main themes of the season of Lent, as well as a message today, continuing a series of messages that I'm doing on reconciliation. So, blessings to you as you watch the video and as you gauge the Lord today. God bless you.
For thousands of years, every morning and evening, Jewish people have prayed these well-known words as a way of expressing their devotion to God. They're called the Shema. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. And as for you, you shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your strength. We're going to look at the second key word here. Lord, written in all capital letters, this is the personal name of Israel's God. We first learn the meaning of this name in the story of Moses and the burning bush in the book of Exodus chapter 3. God appears to Moses and he commissions him to liberate the Israelites from slavery. And so Moses wonders, what if people ask the name of the God who has sent me? And so God responds, tell them, Ehyeh has sent me to you. Now, that Hebrew word Ehyeh means I will be. In other words, God's name means that he is the one who is and who will be. God's existence doesn't depend on anyone or anything else. This God simply is. But It will sound kind of strange for Moses to go say to the Israelites, I will be has sent me to you. Only God can say, I will be. So in the next sentence, God tells Moses the version he should say aloud, Yahweh, the God of our ancestors, he has sent me to you. Now, that word Yahweh is the ancient Hebrew form of the verb he will be. And this is the personal name of the God of Israel. It appears over 6,500 times in the Old Testament. Now, here's what's interesting. Over the centuries, Israelites wanted to honor the sacred nature of this divine name. So, as they read the Hebrew Bible aloud and they came to this name, they stopped saying Yahweh and instead started saying the Hebrew word for Lord, which is Adonai. Now, this practice has been continued throughout the centuries, and so later, when people started translating the Bible into English, they adopted the same practice. Instead of spelling out the divine name, they translated it as Lord, spelled in all capital letters. Okay, you got that? Good, because there's more. Ancient Jewish scribes wanted to prevent anyone from even accidentally saying this name aloud when you read the Hebrew Bible. And so they came up with a visual device to remind you to make sure you say Adonai. They took the four consonant letters of the divine name. These letters correspond to our English letters, Y, H, W, H. Then they inserted the three vowels from the word Adonai and combined these together to create an artificial hybrid word, which if you pronounced it, it would say Yahuwah, but no Israelite ever said Yahuwah. It's simply a visual reminder to say the word Adonai. Now, it gets more interesting. Much later, Christian scribes came along who didn't know that Yahuwah was an artificial word, and so they began to say it aloud and spell it in their writings. This is the word that eventually entered into English as Jehovah. It's a word many people still use today. But the main thing is, the word Lord in all capital letters is an indication of the divine name. Don't confuse it with the word Lord in your English translations that's not in all capital letters. That is the actual Hebrew word Adon, which just means Lord or Master. This word can refer to people like kings or the master of a servant, even a shepherd over his sheep. And sometimes biblical authors will use this word to refer to God, like in the phrases, the Lord of all the earth or the Lord of lords. But behind all of these words, Jehovah, Lord, Adonai, stands the original divine name of the God of Israel. It refers to the one who was, who is, and who forever will be. Thanks for
I love thee, I know thy heart mine. For thee all the faults of sin I resign. My gracious Redeemer, a Savior art thou.
Thank you. No time for fancy introductions today. Got a big story, 13 chapters of the Bible to cover today. So sit back and relax, all right? You think I'm kidding, don't you? In the Galapagos Islands off the coast of Ecuador, there is a species of bird, and it reproduces by laying two eggs a couple of days apart. But the parents only raise one of the chicks of the eggs. You see, when the second egg hatches, the firstborn chick, now just a few days old, actually pushes the second newborn out of the nest over a cliff to die. Yeah. Now, this is known in scientific circles as something called obligate sibling murder. Which you guys, no, I'm not even going to say anything about that. That's its technical name. But it has another name, friends. And when you hear it, I want you to know I'm not making this up. Naturalists actually call this phenomenon the Cain and Abel syndrome. Remember, in this Cain and Abel reality, the second born child is just a spare, just an afterthought, and simply just gets discarded. Very simple. Shocking, but true. Now, I am not a second child. Is anybody a second-born kid in the family? Yeah, okay. Okay, well, don't you feel like you don't necessarily, or you didn't necessarily get the best when you were growing up as a second kid? I know we used to joke in our family that the first kid got all the attention, the second kid got a little less attention. By the time you're a third kid, you could live in the middle of the freeway and your parents really couldn't give a rip. So anyway, Bible scholars actually call this the law of primogeniture. It's part of why the book of Genesis, when you read through the book, friends, you notice that it's kind of a series of sibling wars and battles. For example, Cain and Abel. You know that story. Cain hates Abel, and when God confronts him on that fact, his question is, am I my brother's keeper? And his answer, of course, is no, I'm not. Now, if you read Genesis carefully, one of the things you will find out about this law of primogeniture is that it continually gets overturned. And when you see that, when you're reading the book, you got to take note of that, because God is saying something really important through that reality. You see, in a world where the firstborn is abundantly blessed, God is overturning the law of primogeniture. God is saying that the Lord's blessing is available to those who the world system says are actually unblessed or undesirable. In fact, that message in the Old Testament is a little foretaste of what later gets all turned upside down in what Jesus proclaims in the kingdom of God, where Jesus presents blessings that are available to everyone. Sermon on the Mount, blessed is the poor in spirit, blessed are the meek, blessed are the humble, blessed are the persecuted, etc., etc., etc. In other words, God in Genesis is looking for somebody who will say, Cain couldn't do it, but God is looking for somebody who will say, yes, I am my brother's keeper. And that brings us to this weekend's story. Now, as we go through the story this weekend, I want to invite you to do something. I want to invite you to do this. I want you to think about any broken relationship that you have in your life. I want you to think about that strained relationship that you might have with a family member or a friend or somebody who is important in your life. Maybe it's somebody at work. Maybe it's somebody in the neighborhood. Whatever the case is, think about a person, think about a relationship where you believe you are in need, or that relationship is in some need of healing. And I'd like to humbly ask you to think about committing to that thought and to that kind of like silent running prayer throughout the message, because it would really make what I'm about to share very applicable to you. And that's the point, isn't it? Right? God's word needs to be applied to our lives. So today's story begins with a family in Genesis. It begins with a family in Genesis with 12 brothers, one of whom is named Joseph, and this is how his story starts. Joseph, a young man of 17, was tending the flocks with his brothers, the brothers of Bilhah and the sons of Zilpah, And he brought their father a bad report about them. Some family background here. Joseph's dad, Jacob, had a bunch of sons. He had sons by his first wife, Leah. He had sons by his second wife, Rachel, by Leah's maidservant, Zilpah, and by Rachel's maidservant, Bilhah. And as you can see, just by even my saying all those words about all those kids and all those wives and maidservants, etc., this family is far, far, far from perfect. Pretty dysfunctional. Now in the story, Joseph is the youngest son of Jacob's favorite wife. And Joseph makes it his goal in life to give his father some reports, in this instance, bad reports about all of his older brothers. Now, we're not told in the text what the bad reports are, but apparently Joseph decides, kind of like Cain, that he is not going to be his brother's keeper. In fact, he's behaving early on in this 13th chapter in Genesis story. He's behaving exactly like a spy. And not only that, Joseph, who is his dad's favorite, as the Bible says, and as I mentioned, here it is. Now, Jacob loved Joseph more than any of his other sons because he had been born in his old age. Jacob had this favorite boy, born of his favorite wife, Rachel. And that's a whole other story. Crazy story, actually, in the book of Genesis, which you actually should read because it's not only meaningful, but it's also, in some instances, a little bit entertaining. Well, in the story, we're told that one year, Jacob got a gift. He got a gift for his one favorite son, Joseph. And you've heard about it before. It's an ornate robe. It's an ornate robe. One of the oldest translations of the Bible calls it a coat of many colors. And it had, if you can imagine, kind of a neon sign that was constantly flashing, pointing out to everyone around Joseph that Joseph was dad's favorite. Which begs the question, how do you think Joseph's brother felt about Joseph after he received that wonderful ornate coat? Well, here's how the text basically explains it. Oh, I put it up there. When his brothers saw that their father loved him more than any of them, they hated him and could not speak a kind word to him. Now, friends, this is a very striking fact in the story. So again, look at that verse carefully. It doesn't say that they get mad at their father. Who is the one who's playing favorites? The fact is, nobody in this story talks, you see, about the root of the problem that's been plaguing the family system. Now, before you get to a place in your own life where you're tempted to excuse yourself, let me just say this. This is not a time to throw stones at the characters in the Bible. Why? Because we all too often behave in the exact same manner. Our families do too. You see, the first sign that there is a broken relationship in some sort of family system, in most instances, is not the presentation of violence. It's not the presence of violence. That might be true in some broken relationships, but the first sign in most broken relationships is not violence. It sometimes gets to that extreme, but in the beginning, the first sign, in most instances, the opening sign that there's a problem in a relationship is what you see up on the screen. It's the absence of kindness. You hear that? You kind of see this when people are having a hard time speaking a kind word about a relationship or a family member. In addition to that, you'll notice things in the relationship like withdrawal or avoidance or distancing and ignoring other people. And although you'll often hear in every one of those instances that those things are not meant to wound or damage the relationship any further, the truth is that they do. They always do. Now back to the story, Joseph doesn't help matters any. Genesis tells us that Joseph has this dream early on in this 13 chapter story where all of his brothers are like sheaves of wheat, bundles of wheat in a field, and they symbolically bow down to Joseph. And Joseph decides not to keep this dream to himself. He gathers all of his brothers and he tells them about the dream. And the Bible tells us what we all know, even if it weren't written down for us to be able to see, We all know exactly what happens. And when Joseph told it to his brothers, they hated him even more. Now, friends, in this story, there is no indication that Joseph had a clue about their pain. And if you read the story, and if you read it like this, it's an actual drama, you can probably start to wonder, how could anybody be that clueless? But obviously, in some instances, that's a rhetorical question. Because, we've all been clueless about what harm we do in relationships. Well, the story continues, and in the next verse, the brothers, who by this point are just getting madder and madder at Joseph, are apparently away tending the sheep, and the dad, Jacob, calls the favorite son, Joseph, to him again and says, I think I'm going to send you out to check up on your brothers. In other words, Joseph, I want to send you off to do some more spying, which is what started all the bad blood in the first place. So Joseph goes out to spy on his brothers, who are mad enough to kill him. And in this instance, at this time in the story, he has no parental protection to help him. Now you wonder, how could a parent be that blind? But that too can be a rhetorical question, friends, because you know it. We've all been that blind about the harm that we do in some of our relationships. So Joseph goes out to see his brothers, and while the brothers, they see him, and they see him from a long way off. They recognize him a long way off because they can't see his face, but they recognize what? They recognize that brightly colored robe. And they say to themselves, here comes the dreamer. Come now, let's kill him and say that a ferocious animal devoured him. Now I have to stop here, and I want you just to look, not the screen, not your phone, but at me. There is a kind of wisdom in the text here. And the wisdom is this. Be careful who you talk about your anger with. Often people have the idea that it's always therapeutic to rehearse their anger with a sympathetic friend. But here's the truth. If your friend reinforces your resentment, if your friend reinforces your bitterness and envy, as happens here, because the brothers get together and they commiserate together and they stoke up their common anger at Joseph really being a jerk. If you do that type of thing with a friend, if your resentment and bitterness and envy grows, it's just going to make your anger problem worse. And some people, you just have to know this, some people are anger incubators. They're anger exacerbators. And that's a big, bad deal in relationships. Well, as the story goes, one of the brothers, the fourth-born brother by the name of Judah, we talked about him last week if you were here, he comes up with a plan, a different plan than throwing Joseph to the wild animals to get him killed. Judah suggests that the brothers sell Joseph off into slavery. That way they can get a little bit of cash for their troubles and most definitely avoid a murder charge within that particular community. And what they do is they dip his clothes into goat's blood and they show the bloody clothes to their dad, Jacob, and Jacob thinks an animal has killed his prized son. By the way, what article of Joseph's clothing do you think they dipped in blood? The coat of many colors, the ornate coat. They took the ornate robe back to their father and said, Dad, we found this. Examine it to see whether it is your son's robe. You notice here that they don't say our brother's robe. They don't say Joseph's robe. It's rather your son's robe. That guy, that dreamer. Now you know, we do that same thing when we're mad at somebody. We dehumanize them. It's that person. That person did that to me. See, the brothers didn't even have to lie. They could just let the bloody robe lie for them. So Jacob, in the story, is convinced at this point in the story that Joseph has been killed, and he goes into some deep, deep mourning. Friends, what the real tragic part of the story is at this juncture, make no mistake about it, and this is a huge tragedy, is that the brothers get rid of Joseph, but does it get them what they really want in the depths of their hearts? It doesn't. They do not get their father's love. They do not get their father's respect. They do not get their father's attention. The family doesn't get healed. They get exactly what they asked for, but not what they deeply wanted. But the story goes on. And Joseph is separated from them, the Bible says, for 20 years. And during that time, he's kidnapped, he's enslaved, and eventually he's put into prison. And two of his fellow prisoners, who used to work for the great Pharaoh of Egypt, one night they're both having some troubling dreams. And it seems like in his deep suffering, some of that suffering has actually rubbed off in his heart, and it's changed Joseph. Because the text tells us that now Joseph, who used to be so clueless about his brother's pain, notices that both of the prisoners are saddened. They're sad. And so he asks them about it. He's all of a sudden got some empathy going within his life. And he's able to help them. And as a result, Joseph ends up being brought before the great Pharaoh of Egypt. And then Pharaoh had this weird dream about seven fat cows and seven skinny cows. Now, if you've ever had skinny cow ice cream or ice cream sandwiches, that's where the name comes from. No, it doesn't. I'm just making that up. Joseph tells Pharaoh this dream is about the economy of Egypt. And there's going to be 7 great years of economic growth and 7 years of scarcity. And he goes on to give Pharaoh a strategy about how to get the people of Egypt through those coming difficult times. And Joseph's wisdom, when you read it, is so brilliant. It's just so brilliant that as a result of this, Joseph is made prime minister of the kingdom of Egypt. Well, in the story, right after that, a famine hits. And what do you think? Egypt is ready because of Joseph's guidance. Meanwhile, back home, Jacob and his family, they're starving. And they hear grain and food is available in Egypt. So Jacob sends his sons to get some, but he keeps one of the kids home. His now youngest boy, Benjamin, who, like Joseph used to be, was born to his favorite wife and now is his favorite son. Well, when the brothers arrive in Egypt, they are brought before Joseph to beg for food. And now it's been 22 years. 22 years have gone by since the brothers sold off Joseph into slavery. And the brothers don't recognize Joseph. They don't realize that the powerful guy that they're bowing to, that powerful official, is their brother. They bow down before him. They lay their faces on the ground, by the way, just like in those dreams. Joseph recognizes them, the text tells us. Joseph remembers, but he chooses not to tell them who he is. And friends, that's one of the key points in the story. Joseph pretends to be a stranger. He speaks harshly to them. He actually accuses them of being spies. Strange twist in the story, by the way. And they tell him, no, we're, your servants are honest men. We're not spies. Your servants, we're 12 brothers, the son of one man who lives in the land of Canaan. The youngest is now with our father, and one is no more. Of course, that's Joseph. He's dead, according to their memory. And if that's true, go home, Joseph says, and bring your little brother back as proof, and I will give you what you need, and you will live. Now, the reader, of course, is going to wonder, when you're going through the story, why didn't Joseph just tell them who he was? They're very desperate. At this point, they'll do whatever he asks. You got to wonder, does he just want them to squirm a little bit? Maybe is he getting a little bit of maybe revenge back at them? Well, friends, the reason is that Joseph doesn't just want to forgive them. He doesn't want just to let go of his resentment. Joseph wants to reconcile with them. He wants to reconcile with them. He wants to reestablish a relationship. But he knows what's true in a lot of relationships, most relationships, that healing in relationships takes time. And in many instances, in broken or strained relationships, it also takes a demonstration of trust. Now, friends, Jesus followers will sometimes throw the word reconciliation around a little bit too lackadaisically, in ways that can actually do a little bit of harm. That's why this story is so very important. This story tells us and shows us how costly genuine reconciliation actually is. And that's why we're doing this story today. Reconciliation with God, reconciliation with each other, that in value, the relational value of what it means for us to be Jesus followers. Well, Joseph tells his brothers that they must leave one brother as collateral with him in Egypt until they go back to get some of what their father wanted them to be able to get in the first place. And so they have to go back, they have to get the younger brother, and the brothers say to each other, Surely we're going to be punished because our brother Joseph, we saw how distressed he was when he pleaded with us for his life, but we would not listen. That's why this distress has come upon us. Now, this too is a real poignant verse. You see, in the initial story, the writer of Genesis does not record any words of Joseph pleading for his life when his brothers betrayed him and sold him off to slave traders. But now, 20 years later, 22 years later, his brothers remember how Joseph pleaded for his life in that instance. Now, you see, they do not call him the dreamer. Now they do not call him dad's favorite. He is our brother Joseph. Joseph, unknown to them, begins to see this change. He sees it right in front of his very eyes. He sees the change in his brothers that's happened in their hearts over 22 years. And when Joseph sees that and he hears what they have to say, Genesis tells us that Joseph turns away from them and he begins to secretly have a time of weeping. But the story goes on. And the brothers go home. And for a long time, their dad will not allow them to return because he does not want to lose Benjamin. But the famine is so relentless that in desperation, Jacob sends all the boys back to Egypt, dragging in tow his now favorite son, Benjamin. And when they get back to Egypt, Joseph arranges a feast. Remember, at this point, the brothers still do not know who Joseph is. And there's a little oddity in this part of the story. When portions are served during the feast to all the brothers at Joseph's table, Benjamin's portion is 5 times greater than anybody else's. And that's kind of a strange gesture. You got to wonder, why did he do that? Now, one more time, the youngest son is being treated as a favorite. And I think that Joseph is doing that, and he's just watching. He's watching, how are my brothers going to respond? Has anything changed over the years? And so Joseph just watches. Well, the brothers leave, and Joseph seems to be just overwhelmingly, extraordinarily generous with them. He says he's going to send them back home to his dad with all the grain that they want. In fact, they don't even have to pay for it. He gives them their money back, which is absolutely amazing. And then he has his servants go after them and bring them back to Egypt because he's missing something. He's missing a treasure. He's missing this silver cup, a priceless silver cup. We don't know whether it's his favorite possession or not. All we know is that all of their belongings, all the brothers' belongings are searched, and the cup, the silver cup, is found where? In Benjamin's backpack. And Joseph says, the rest of the brothers may leave, but Benjamin, daddy's favorite, has got to stay in Egypt. And Benjamin, as far as they're concerned, is going to rot in prison. A great rabbi in the Middle Ages said, a true penitent is a person who commits a sin and later is given an opportunity to commit the same sin, but refuses. So here are the brothers once more with their younger brother, whom their father loves most of all, and they can be rid of him. They did it before, right, with Joseph? This time, they don't even have to do anything wrong. Nothing. As far as they know, it's probably Benjamin's fault anyway. He's the one who took the cup. But then in the middle of this tension-filled situation and circumstance, one of the brothers, Judah, stands up. Judah, whose idea it was to betray and sell Joseph in the first place, and he was the one who deceived his father 22 years before. Judah, whose idea it was to betray and violate his daughter-in-law, Tamar, that we looked at and talked about last week. That Judah stands up and makes the longest and most impassionate speech in the entire book of Genesis. He says that if he and his brothers go back from Egypt to the promised land without Benjamin, they would bring their father's gray head down in misery. He goes on, he says, if my father, whose life is closely bound up with this young boy's life, sees that the boy isn't here, he will die. Your servants will bring the gray head of your own father down to the grave in sorrow. I guess people with gray hair are a little sensitive. So Judah says to Joseph, again, he doesn't even know who Joseph is. He says to Joseph, we have an aged father, and there is a young son born to him in his old age. His brother is dead. He's talking about Joseph there. And he is the only one of his mother's. That's Rachel, his favorite wife. And he is the only one of his mother's sons left, and his father deeply loves him. Now note here that Judah doesn't say, my father loves me. Or he doesn't say, our father loves us. There's still a flaw in the family system. But Judah now knows that the path of envy and resentment and hatred and self is the path toward death. It's caused him all sorts of ruin within his own life. And Judah starts to change. And then comes the climax of the entire book. Judah says, let me take the place of the boy Benjamin. I will go to prison. Let my brother go free. I will suffer on behalf of my brother rather than seeing suffering inflicted upon him. And for the first time in the ancient world, friends, punishment is seen in a new light with the possibility of redemption. So when the question arises, am I my brother's keeper? The question that would have been responded to with a verbal, loud, almost obnoxious no in every other story early on in the book of Genesis. Finally, for the first time, with full awareness of all the consequences, the ancient haunting question, am I my brother's keeper, is answered with a yes. And it comes at great cost by probably the worst of Jacob's sons. But now Joseph knows. After hearing what Judah has to say, Joseph knows that these brothers have changed. They're not the same men before. They have become their brother's keeper. Now he's able not just to let go of resentment, but Joseph actually lets reconciliation commence. Jewish rabbis, in reflecting upon the story, have written, this is the day that forgiveness was invented in human history. So there was no one with Joseph when he made himself known to his brothers, and he wept so loudly that the Egyptians heard him, and Pharaoh's household heard all about it. His brothers were too stunned to take it all in, so he had them gather close to him and told them again, I am your brother Joseph, the one you sold into Egypt. You know, sometimes we use the phrase forgive and forget, but they're not the same. In fact, if you forget something, you can't forgive it. Joseph doesn't forget. Joseph is not living in denial. Joseph doesn't pretend that what he went through didn't hurt. He doesn't excuse or rationalize what his brothers did. He brings God, though, into the equation. And now do not be distressed and do not be angry with yourselves for selling me here. One of the most powerful verses in the entire Bible. Because it was to save lives that God sent me ahead of you. And this is so crucial about this lesson, about this whole idea of reconciliation, friends. Attempts at reconciliation in our world can be damaging if they are done too quickly or done with somebody who is not genuinely repentant or genuinely trustworthy. It would not have been right for Joseph to say, "Don't be distressed," until he knew they were deeply distressed. He couldn't say that unless he knew they had changed, that they were now trustworthy. Let me say, pain and distress over wrongdoing are indispensable parts of our spiritual growth and moral development and health. And you got to know, if somebody has wronged you, you can let go of your desire for revenge, even if they're unrepentant. You can decide not to live in a prison of resentment if they don't repent. But reconciliation, the rebuilding of a relationship, requires repentance and time and the demonstration of trustworthiness. And that's what happens here in this story over 22 years. And finally, the brothers are healed. We're told then near the end of the story that Joseph gives them carts and he gave them provisions for their journey. To each of them, he gave some new clothes. Now, it doesn't take, well, a lot of time to be able to see in the text. There's no word about what those clothes look like, but my guess is, at least my imagination tells me, it must have been very colorful robes. And if that was not powerful enough, sometime later their dad, Jacob, is dying. And the story tells us that he gathers his sons around them to give them a blessing. And the most important blessing does not go to Benjamin. The most important blessing does not go to Joseph, the golden boy. The most important blessing goes to Judah. Judah. Jacob says, "Judah, your brothers will praise you. Your father's sons will bow down to you. You are a lion's cub, Judah, the scepter." Scepter is what kings hold. "The scepter will not depart from Judah, nor the ruler's staff from between his feet, until he to whom it belongs shall come, and the obedience of the nations will be his. He will tether his donkey to a vine, his colt to the choicest branch. He will wash his garments in wine, his robes in the blood of grapes." The scepter, the crown, the kings of Israel will not come, friends, from Joseph. They will not come from Benjamin, but they'll come from Judah. A king one day named David, and then another king of another kind who will be called the son of David, the Lion of Judah, who one day on Palm Sunday will ride into Jerusalem on a donkey, the symbol not of military might, but of peace and reconciliation. His robe will be taken from him. His robe will be washed in blood. And he will say, as his ancestor Judah said way before him, centuries before him, "Let the punishment fall on me. Let the cross come to me. I will drink the cup. I am my brother's keeper." Because as Paul says, God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. Brothers and sisters, through Jesus, you could be reconciled to God. You can be accepted and loved in spite of your own personal brokenness. But there are implications to that reconciliation. Because we cannot say, "God, I want to accept your gift of reconciliation and acceptance of me and for me, but I do not want to reconcile with anybody else. I want to take from you, but I don't want to give it to them." And friends in Jesus, the way of envy and resentment, let me tell you, has been tried and tried and tried before, and it always leads to death. So today, where is God calling you to reconcile, or at least seek it? As we wrap this up, where is reconciliation being spoken to by the Spirit of God in your life? Maybe, again, you have a brother or sister or a mom or a dad or a son or a daughter or a friend or a neighbor. Reconciliation will be hard. Reconciliation will be messy. Reconciliation might be confusing. It may take repeated conversations. It may take 22 years. We all know this. Something you might not necessarily realize is that there are always difficult people in our lives, right? And the truth is, we actually need them. We really do. Difficult people are part of our growth. And I'll tell you this, if you do not have a difficult person in your life, email me, because I keep a list of difficult people, and I will be happy to assign you one. In fact, some of them are sitting here today. Seriously, I want to ask you if you'll make a commitment that whatever note you have to write, whatever call you have to make, that you will pursue reconciliation in light of what God through Christ has done for you. Now, one more pastoral word here, a word, brother in Christ, to you. I know many of you have suffered what might be called a deep hurt, a deep betrayal. Somebody's rejected you. Somebody's hurt you. Somebody's abused you. You've been lied to or lied about. Maybe it's been done deliberately. Maybe it's been done openly. And currently it's unacknowledged. It hasn't been repented of, and it's definitely unconfessed. I know what that is like, trust me. Ironically, or maybe not, as I was preparing this week, I've got a strained relationship in my life right now, and this relationship is really important to me. And I know that I need to have a long conversation with this person, and I pray, I hope, that it will lead to reconciliation. Now, the details don't matter. And the truth is, the relationship has gone through some strains before, but it's been healed. And it's kind of a painful time right now. But when I was thinking about that, I thought to myself, at least I haven't been kidnapped and enslaved and thrown in jail like Joseph. And frankly, I don't know if full reconciliation will ever come. I don't know. That can only be based upon the full acknowledgement of truth and a reestablishment of genuine trust. But I know, friends, my own capacity for brooding and resentment and self-pity. And I also know this. I know when Joseph was kidnapped, the Bible says God was with Joseph in slavery. When he was arrested, the Bible says God was with Joseph in prison. And so you need to know, just as I need to remind myself, Jesus is our Emmanuel, which means God is with us. So God is with you right now. I'll make you a deal. I will ask God every day to give me the power to be my God-honoring self. I will never give up on the dream of reconciliation. I will never give up on the truth. Sin confessing, wrong amending, heart healing, God-empowered reconciliation. I will never give that up. And I will continue to pray and work and hope for that and ask you to do the exact same thing in your life, to be a reconciliation seeker in your life. If I do that as prayerfully as I can, how about you? Is that a deal? And then we can seek reconciliation and honoring God together. Let's pray, okay? Lord, this story is just absolutely amazing. So many different nuances, but God, they all bring us to the same place, a reconciling relationship with you and with each other. Lord, I know that many people were thinking about a face, or maybe a couple of faces of people during this time of the message where reconciliation is a tough call right now. But God, we have been reconciled with you at great cost. And so, Lord God, we pray for your Spirit's power and enablement to be those not only who embrace the gracious gift of reconciliation through Christ, but also who give it and live it, that we live a reconciliation lifestyle. May that be true for every single one of us, Lord God. In your name we pray. Amen.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
And in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary,
suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried.
He descended to hell.
The third day he rose again from the dead.
He ascended to heaven
and sits on the right hand of the Father Almighty,
from whence he shall come to judge the living and the dead.
I believe in the Holy Spirit,
the Holy Catholic Church,
the communion of saints,
the forgiveness of sins,
the resurrection of the body,
and the life everlasting.
Amen.
Let's pray together. Why don't you bow your heads and we'll pray the Lord's Prayer together, shall we? Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And now receive the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and grant you his peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.